Hi folks, welcome to our Sunday video. It's nice to see you again. I've got a couple of announcements to make before we get started today. The first is about a pastoral questionnaire. I mentioned to you before that the last time the session met, we wanted to send out a questionnaire to the congregation so that we can best establish what the pastoral needs are of the congregation so that we can better serve everyone in the future. If you've not received that yet, you will be receiving it in the next few days. And we'd ask you please to take time to consider it, fill it out, and return it to the church, or by post, or in person, to the church by the 6th of June. We really appreciate folks taking the time to do this. It will really help us going forward to know how best to care for the congregation. And then secondly, to say that this coming week it is the General Assembly of the Church of Scotland, and I'm a commissioner this year. Now, that means I'm not going to be very free this week. I'm afraid I'm going to be quite involved with that, so I won't be as free as normal. Usually in normal times, if I was going to the Assembly, I would be down in Edinburgh all week. I wouldn't be with you. However, just with COVID, everything's online. So what it means really is that not only am I going to be busy doing this, but just as if I was away, we've arranged for some pastoral cover for funerals. And Matt Alexander from the Baptist Church is the person who's covering for me this week. So if you need services of a minister for funerals, please contact him. That's all of our notices. We're going to begin now with our first song.
2, 3, 4.
Joy shall fill my heart. then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. And then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou
Lord God, you are great and greatly to be praised. You're the one who has made the world beautiful as it is around us. This beautiful creation that speaks of your glory and tells us of your character. But Lord, we thank you that this is not all we have. We have your very own revelation of yourself, principally and ultimately in your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, and the scriptures that point to him, that tell us all about your plan in him to bring redemption and salvation and hope in a dark and broken and twisted world. Lord God, we thank you so much for who you are and what you have achieved. And we praise you for Christ, for all that is ours in him, for his life and death and resurrection on our behalf. And we ask, Lord God, just as we watch the video today, or as we listen in on the phone line, that you would be with us by your Holy Spirit, speaking to us more of yourself, drawing us more to Christ, helping us more to follow him. We pray, Lord God, just that you would build us up in him, that we would know more and more what it is to be his people, to walk the life of faith that you've called us to be his faithful kingdom subjects. Lord God, we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Colossians 2:6-23. So then, just as you received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live your lives in him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught and overflowing with thankfulness. See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the elemental spiritual forces of this world, rather than on Christ. For in Christ all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form, and in Christ you have been brought to fullness. He is the head over every power and authority. In him you are also circumcised with a circumcision not performed by human hands. Your whole self, ruled by the flesh, was put off when you were circumcised by Christ, having been buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through your faith in the working of God, who raised him from the dead. When you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all our sins, having canceled the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us. He has taken it away, nailing it to the cross. And having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. Therefore, do not let anyone judge you by what you eat or drink, or with regard to a religious festival, a new moon celebration, or a Sabbath day. These are a shadow of the things that were to come. The reality, however, is found in Christ. Do not let anyone who delights in false humility and the worship of angels disqualify you. Such a person also goes into great detail about what they have seen. They are puffed up with idle notions by their unspiritual mind. They have lost connection with the head, from whom the whole body, supported and held together by its ligaments and sinews, grows as God causes it to grow. Since you died with Christ to the elemental spiritual forces of this world, why, as though you still belong to the world, do you submit to its rules? Do not handle, do not taste, do not touch. These rules, which have to do with things that are all destined to perish with use, are based on merely human commands and teachings. Such regulations indeed have an appearance of wisdom, with their self-imposed worship, their false humility, and their harsh treatment of the body, but they lack any value in restraining sensual indulgence.
Well, there are some times in life where we learn lessons, which aren't necessarily complicated lessons, but they are lessons that are very key, very vital to our life, and they take a long while to filter down through into all of our life. I'm thinking maybe of lessons we learn about ourselves, maybe through times of adversity, maybe it's through different experiences we go through, we learn things about ourselves or about the world. And these in themselves are not complicated, but we understand them on a deeper level. Or perhaps it's when things in life change, when we have a change in circumstances of life. Perhaps when we move to a new area, or perhaps when we have a change in our lives. There's things we need to adjust to, and we know it in some ways, but then it takes a while to sink in. A really silly example of this that's really not important but funny is when we first moved here to Wick, I found when I looked at the weather forecast, I kept looking to the wrong part of the country. I needed to remember that we were up here, not in Inverness, not in the Central Belt, not in the other parts of the UK that I've lived in before. And in some ways, as we continue with the book of Colossians, what Paul is really teaching these Christians is a very simple lesson. It's that he wants them to continue in Christ. We've seen over a few weeks that this has been the lesson, and I think I said last week that we're right now in this passage at the very heart of the message of Colossians, where Paul on the one hand is yes saying continue in Christ, but also not to be deceived and be led astray from Christ. These Colossian Christians need it because they have various forces among them and upon them which seem to want to lead them away from Christ. Last week we thought a bit about this together, about what it means to continue in Christ, and we thought about religious ways that we might be led astray from Christ, either by super Christianity or by what we call natural Christianity. Today, what I want to do is I want to push on forward with the rest of what Paul says in this section, and I want to show us what we do receive if we do continue in Christ, that there is fullness and fellowship and forgiveness and freedom if we continue in Christ. These are wonderful things, and actually often the reasons we would want to look elsewhere. But at the same time, as we do go through these four things today, I want to weave in one non-religious way that we might be led astray from Christ and show that continuing in Christ is always better because it brings these things. So we begin firstly with fullness in Christ. Last week we finished with the warning not to be deceived, and I talked about two religious ways we might be deceived, but let me now shed light on a non-religious way we might be deceived today in our culture. This is a big thing, and it's almost so impervious to our culture that it's unnoticeable. It's like the water we swim in, the air we breathe, it's all around us all the time. And it's the idea of self being the most important thing. That we are arbiters of our own truth, masters of our own destiny, that we should look inside of ourselves to find ourselves and then perform it, and that is the way to happiness and fullness and freedom. Let me give you some examples. I'm sure over these last months you've seen all the stories with Harry and Meghan and with them leaving the royal family and so on. Now, I'm not wanting to criticise their decision per se, but I want you to think about how they made the decision. Well, what did they do but look inside themselves and decide that they wanted to be masters of their own destiny, arbiters of their own truth? They wanted to find their truth, their way, and that was the best way to happiness rather than fulfilling certain duties that they had to the crown. This is everywhere. It's even in children's films. If you watch children's films with your grandchildren, you'll see the same story played out again and again, that somebody is held back by their society or by their family, and their best way is for them to go their own way. Maybe you've seen Frozen, and the famous song in Frozen, Let It Go. She sings, "Turn away and slam the door, I don't care what they're going to say, let the storm rage on." I.e., I want to leave it all behind. I want to go my own path. And we see it in other ways, and it actually is the story, it's the idea behind much of the very sharp shift in social attitudes we have in our society today. So you may perhaps have seen in the news in the past few weeks that there was someone on a train in the UK, and the train conductor announced "ladies and gentlemen," and they went and complained because they would say that they are neither male nor female, they are non-binary, and they wanted to be apologised to. They looked inside themselves, this is what they saw, and they had to perform it to the world, and everyone should be in line with them because that is their truth. And maybe if you've seen the news this week, the singer Demi Lovato said something similar. She said that she now wants to be they and them, not she and her. And this is what Demi Lovato said. "I'm proud to let you know that I identify as non-binary and will be officially changing my pronouns. This best represents the fluidity I feel in my gender expression." Now again, I'm not really wanting to talk about her individually, but how did she come to the decision? She says, it came from healing and self-reflective work. She looked inside of herself to find her own path, her own way. Who is she according to herself? And this is what she says, and now she wants to project it. Well, I don't know what you make of these things. There are some small things there, some big things there. And it may be that we are likely to have one of two reactions. Either we think this is wonderful and we should support people in these things, or perhaps we think this is horrendous and terrible and we get angry, we want to dismiss it. Well, in our country there is also this notion of this increasing culture war, that you're either this side or that side. And it's easy for people to line up their Christianity either in the traditional way or in the new way. But we don't really want to be part of that culture war, because Christianity does not fit neatly into either. To be a Christian is not to be giving ourselves to one side. It's to say we have a completely different way. That we are Christians, we are in Christ, we have a new life with him. Not just a different way of seeing life, but an actual different life with him. And that's where we come back to Colossians. You see, people use this language of identities, and if you want to use that language, I suppose you could say that being a Christian is a different identity, a different kind of identity, an identity like no other. Because in every other identity, it's either something that's inherent to you that you've got to proclaim to the world or establish in the world, or something you look inside of yourself and find and project. Here we read being a Christian is so different. It's an identity like no other. For in Christ all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form, and in Christ you have been brought to fullness. Do you see? Fullness is not from ourselves. It's from Christ, in Christ, in whom all fullness already is. It's, as we know in the message of the gospel, Jesus, who's fully God and fully man, came to us, who were spiritually dead, spiritually empty, and he gave himself for us, emptying himself, and did that on the cross to reconcile us to God, but rose again because of his power, because of his fullness, to bring a new life and a new way. And if we are Christians, if we have faith in Christ, then we are part of this. We are given a place in this, not dependent on us, not defined by us, something we receive as a gift, so that we now have fullness. We have been brought to fullness in Christ. Secondly, we see fellowship with Christ in verses 11 to 13. We're seeing how this identity in Christ, being a Christian, is just so different. It's an identity not like any other. Here, Paul is talking to the Colossians, and he's talking to them, interacting with some of the things that are around them, which isn't always simple to understand, but we're going to work through it together. I think the key to this next little section is to see that he's trying to show them the fellowship they have with Christ. That as they are in Christ, he is with them. And this is important as we think about identities, because again, as we think about identities, as people think about it today, it's something that we achieve. We look and find it ourselves, we have to then project it and perform it ourselves. We maybe have to gather others around us who will support us in it, but it's all being driven by us. Well, this is where Christianity is so, so different. Paul is telling these Christians that in Christ, they have something that has been achieved for them if they are in Christ. So, and some of these concepts might be new to you, but keep with me. He says that they were circumcised by Christ. Circumcision in the Old Testament was the physical sign given to little boys in the Jewish community to bring them in, to show that they were part of God's people. Here, Paul says, do you see, to Christians, you have been circumcised by Christ. You have been brought in by him. He has done it. He has achieved it in his life and death and resurrection. And by the Spirit coming to them, he has brought them in. And he expands on it. He goes through a logical cycle, I think. He says not only were they brought in by Christ, circumcised by Christ, that this is better than circumcision. It was circumcision not performed by human hands. It didn't depend on an external rite that had to be performed. Now, whether this is specifically the issue in Colossae or not, we're not sure. But they would be aware of what Paul was talking about. And it may be that there were other non-Jewish practices that they were being encouraged to take part in. But he is saying to them, don't trust in the external practices. Look to what Christ has done and what he has done now in you. In Christ, you have this deeper thing, this greater thing. And it's not done by you. It's been done by him. And he then goes on, he talks about baptism, a greater circumcision, you might say, not just a welcoming in, but a dying with Christ and rising again. And just as Christ was raised from the dead, so they now in Christ have the power of God that raised Christ from the dead. And so, and I know these are complicated things to bring together, but I think what he's trying to say is that in Christ they have this settled, secure status, this foundation that they can live out of, achieved by Christ, brought to them by his grace, received by the power of the Spirit, something that has welcomed them in and built them in to him And it doesn't depend on them. It's all about Christ. This new life with Christ they have is wonderful. And in it they have everything they will ever need. We see that in Paul, actually, even as he's talked about his own life. Do you remember in chapter 1 how he said that he strenuously contends, but with all the power that Christ powerfully works in him? He's taking his place in this new life with Christ, and he's giving himself to it completely. And in it, he knows God's power and God's help. He knows security. He is with Christ in everything. There's a deep fellowship for Paul with Jesus, even when he's alone. He is doing everything with and for Christ. The whole life, this whole new way of life, this whole new life he has, is centered around loving Jesus and obeying Jesus. And it gives him this wonderful sense of being part of Christ in his life. Now, do you notice how that's so different to what I'm saying about people today and what we say about identities? Not only is it something that is given so that we don't have to dream it up, it's not something we have to keep performing at. It's not something we have to keep earning or striving to keep going. If we're in Christ, as we carry on in life with Christ, it's not dependent on us. It's that we are connected to the one in whom there is all fullness. And we are with him, and we have this deep fellowship with him. And he has enough for us. And he has more than enough, because in him is all the fullness of God. Thirdly, we have forgiveness in Christ, in the end of verse 13 to 15. In the world as we know it, in this world of identities, where people look inside themselves and have to project and perform, it's all about getting ourselves out there, getting our ideas, our own truth out there. And what it brings in our society, and I think we see this increasingly, is not peace and freedom as we want, but clashing and hostility. Because if everyone's trying to put themselves across or put their own understanding of themselves across, then all it leads to is clashing. Whether it's our social views, whether it's our political views, whether it's just ourselves and what we want out of life. Well, what do we need? We need reconciliation today. Our world needs reconciliation from everything, from within families, households, to our communities, to our nation, to the world. There's hostility and anger and bitterness all over the place, isn't there? Well, what our world misses is forgiveness. And the very heart of the Christian message is about forgiveness. The very heart of this Christian identity that's not really like any other identity is forgiveness in Christ. You see, Paul takes these Colossians again back to the gospel. The gospel that we said last week is like the Swiss Army knife of the Christian life. It's good for every situation. Who can do such a big task? Well, if you remember back in Colossians 1, we saw that Christ is great. He had this amazing vision of Christ in all his fullness. He is the one who can do this great thing. Now, in the Bible we read, it's not just that humans clash with one another, it's that we're actually at war with God. But in Christ, God has come to make terms of peace. And it's not just a nice gesture, it was a costly thing. It's that God, the Holy One, came to those of us who were sinful to bring us redemption, salvation. It's that God came to pay the debt of the debtors, that he came and put his life on the line for his enemies. It's that at great cost he came to bring reconciliation, because only he could do it. And yet he did it even though he was the wronged one. He did it even though he was the one who could rightly have said that we, humanity, deserve to be cast away in judgment. At the cross, we read, having cancelled the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us, he has taken it away, nailing it to the cross. We know forgiveness, deep forgiveness in Christ. Well, finally, we're going to finish with the freedom in Christ from verse 17 to 23. It seems that the Colossians were under pressure. We've said this a few times, and I know I've been quite vague, but it's because I'm not exactly sure what was going on. There was something that was pressurising them, someone, some force, some people, perhaps inside or outside of the church, to take part in other things that would really bring them fullness, that would really give them the deep experience that they think they need. The key, I think, is just to see that there's that dynamic going on, even if we can't diagnose exactly what it was. There's lots of things mentioned here. So, for example, it could be that there was pressure for them to carry on with some Jewish practices. In verse 16 we read, therefore do not let anyone judge you by what you eat or drink, or with regard to a religious festival, new moon celebration, or a Sabbath day. Or it may be that there was some other kind of rite out with the Christian community, some kind of super spiritual experience, like is alluded to in verse 18. Do not let anyone who delights in false humility and the worship of angels disqualify you. Such a person also goes into great detail about what they have seen. They are puffed up with idle notions by their unspiritual mind. Whatever it is, they're being pressurised to seek something out with Christ. But Paul rebuts this heavily in these next verses. In fact, he goes on to say that those who would do those things, any Christian who's led astray into these other things, is like a headless Christian. Verse 19, they have lost connection with the head, from whom the whole body is supported and held together by its ligaments and sinews, grows as God causes it to grow. Over a few weeks we've used this image of a tree that we want to go down deeper into Christ, and that's where our strength and fruitfulness will come. And this is the same thing really, but it's the body. We have a phrase in English, don't we, that we talk about running about like headless chickens. Well, here Paul is saying that these people would be running about like headless Christians, that there's no life there, that there's no goodness there. Really, to be a Christian is to be part of the body of Christ, to be under Christ, the head, to take our place with the other believers, not seek special extra things that are just for a few. It's interesting, isn't it, that actually this image is a corporate image. It's saying that you can really only be a Christian really truly as you're part of the body, not going off yourself, not going off into special things. It's life together. Life with Christ, yes, but life together. And Paul presses it home in verses 20 to 22. Since you died with Christ to the elemental spiritual forces of the world, why, as though you still belong to the world, do you submit to its rules? Do not handle, do not taste, do not touch. These rules, which have to do with things that are all destined to perish with use, are based merely on human commandments and teachings. So you see, Paul is saying to them, don't be pressured to go off into these other things. Don't seek fullness elsewhere. Don't think you don't have enough. Keep with Christ. Over the last month or so, I heard Nicola Sturgeon say to us as a nation, as we continue to go through our pandemic, the phrase, keep the heed, i.e. don't lose it, don't throw it all away now. And that's what Paul is saying here to these Christians, don't lose the head, which is Christ. Don't go off seeking spiritual life and nourishment anywhere else. It's the same as the tree image, but with a head and a body. And Paul then finishes by showing that this does genuinely bring freedom. In verse 23, he rails against these other things again. He says, such regulations indeed have an appearance of wisdom, with their self-imposed worship, their false humility, and their harsh treatment of the body. But they lack any value in restraining sensual indulgence. Paul is saying these things do not have power. They purport to have power. They say they're great spiritual experiences. They say they'll help you live a better life, a different life. But really, the only true freedom is in Christ. You see, it's in Christ where we can grow. It's in Christ we can be strengthened. It's in Christ that we can know God's power. And we can be changed. Changed from our old lives of sensual indulgence to a life pleasing to God. He's going to talk more about this in the later part of the letter. But the foundation is here. It's being in Christ and staying with Christ. It involves some hard things. It involves putting to death our ambitions of who we want to be. It puts to death the sense of what we think is right. It's a scary thing. It's letting go of control and putting ourselves under Christ as Lord and saying that His way is the best way. But it's worth it because we know who He is. We know our Lord Jesus. We know His goodness. We know His mercy. We know His kindness and compassion, and we want to be like this. And the way Jesus says to be like this is to continue with Him. There are some suggestions as to what might be going on here in Colossae. And again, I keep stressing, I don't know exactly. There's a suggestion that there might be some kind of evil powers involved, some demonic forces. Now, that may be true. It may have been an explicit, super spiritual demonic thing. Or it may just be that Satan was at work trying to lure these Christians away. Whenever we see Christians being lured away, it is the work of Satan. And so Paul's insistence here is that Christ is more, greater, more powerful. He is over spiritual evil. And as we saw a couple of times in the passage, that He has defeated spiritual evil. Even at the point where He talks about the cross, He didn't just talk about the cancelling of our legal indebtedness. He talks about how Christ triumphed over all spiritual forces. He is greater. There's also a suggestion of false external traditions. And Paul again is saying they don't have power. Don't follow after them. And he also then talks about the judgment of others. And perhaps actually this is the biggest thing for us as Christians today, because to continue to be with Christ, to genuinely embrace Him and His exclusive claims, will put us at odds with the world. But we know that in Him is all goodness, all fullness, all truth, all beauty, all spiritual life, all kindness. If we would continue with Him, stick our roots deep in Him, be strengthened by Him, and be overflowing with thankfulness as we saw last week, that we would have the fruit of His Spirit, the fruits of life with Him, that we would continue with Him and so come to maturity. Not look for shortcuts, not look elsewhere, not look to hyper things, not look to natural things, but to continue with Christ. There is fullness. There is fellowship and forgiveness and freedom. Lord Jesus, you have told us that broad is the road that leads to destruction and narrow is the path that leads to life. We thank you that this is a path that you have laid out for us. You have made it possible in your life and death and resurrection on our behalf. And by the help of your Spirit, you have helped promise to lead us through that narrow path, the path of following your ways, the path of being faithful to you, the path of honouring you and enduring in our faith. We ask that you would help us to continue on that path, not to be distracted, not to be deceived, but to know all the fullness and freedom and forgiveness and joy and fellowship we have with you day by day. Keep us faithful, we ask. We thank you so much for all that you've done for us and all that you do for us and all that we have in this wonderful spiritual life, which is a gift to us. Build us up as your people, we ask, even amidst the struggles and trials of our day. Show us more of who you are and help us to live in utter awe and worship of you for your glory. We pray for our congregation that you would continue to build us up in you. Help us to be shaped more into your likeness. Help us to always honour you with our thoughts and words and deeds. And Lord, we pray this not just for ourselves, but for our whole denomination, that she would be brought to following you faithfully. As the General Assembly meets in this next week, we ask that you would help her to care most of all about you and to be your faithful bride, to listen to your voice in the scriptures and to not reject them, to go to you in her weakness, to seek your leading and guiding and help. Lord, we recognise that in many ways we have not followed your voice and we are sorry for this. We number ourselves in that denomination as those who haven't always followed what you have commanded. Yet we ask for your mercy to turn us back to you, to be faithful and holy, and to live in righteousness. Lord Jesus, we also want to pray for our nation. We thank you that your gospel is going out and bearing fruit across our nation, and we ask that it would continue to do so, that other men and women, boys and girls, might come too and see what it is to be in you, to live that life of faith and to know that new identity, which is not like any other identity, of a new life in you. We pray that you would help us locally with our efforts towards this. And we pray that the gospel would bear fruit in this nation once more. We also pray that you would be upholding and strengthening your church around the world, in all different countries, whether folks have life easy as Christians or whether it is difficult. We pray especially for churches where there is persecution and disturbance, for those who face great trials in terms of the things of life, that whatever their situation is, that you would prove yourself faithful and that you would help them. We pray too that you would help us as a church in this country to learn from our brothers and sisters around the world what it means to live faithfully for you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, thanks for watching along today, folks. Just to mention that next Sunday there will be a video as normal, but we'll be having a guest speaker because I'll be involved with the General Assembly, Sean Clokey from Trinity Church in Liphook.